Hi, this is Carrie Brownstein.
This is DJ Premier.
This is Darren Aronofsky.
You got the RZA right here.
Rose McGowan.
Right here.
Aisha Tyler.
A Tribe Called Quest.
Fred Armisen.
Fritz Paul.
Javier Munoz. Seth Meyers.
Frankie Cosmos.
Flying Lotus.
Hi, we're Chaim, and you're listening to the Talkhouse Podcast.
Hello, and welcome to the Talkhouse Podcast. I'm Josh Modell. On this week's episode, we've got a pair of friends who, as you'll hear, have provided emotional support and advice to each other throughout interesting, winding careers over the past couple of decades. Mary Timony and Joe Wong. Now, Timony is probably best known as the leader of the 90s indie rock band Helium, but her catalog goes far beyond it. Prior to that band, Timony came up in the DC punk scene as part of the band Autoclave, and after, she's been part of Wild Flag with members of Sleater-Kinney, fronted a band called X-Hex, and released records under her own name. That's mostly why we're here today, because Timony is about to release her first solo record in 15 years, and it's fantastic. It's called Untame the Tiger, and it picks up on some of the psych elements that Timony has wrangled in the past, and even includes a guest appearance by the former drummer of Fairport Convention, Dave Maddox, as you'll hear in this chat. Untame the Tiger was also produced in part by today's other guest, Joe Wong. It comes out February 23rd, but check out a little bit of the song Dominoes right here.
When you said it was forever, you looked me right in the eye. The next second you were gone, that's when I realized that was a lie.
As I mentioned, today's other guest is Joe Wong, who grew up in Milwaukee and played in indie rock bands before finding his creative path in two amazing ways, as a composer for TV and film and as a podcast host. He's written music for the likes of Russian Doll and Master of None, and he helms the popular podcast The Trap Set, which originated as a way to spotlight his favorite drummers, but has since expanded into deep and incredible conversations with all kinds of creative folks. But a few years back, partly at the urging of his friend Mary Timony, Wong began writing songs for himself rather than for other people's scores. He just released his second album, Mere Survival, and while it still has late 60s big pop vibes, it gets even bigger and weirder than his first. It features not only Timony, but also Pearl Jam's Matt Cameron, among other guests. Check out a little bit of the title track from Mere Survival right here.
With every breath, we're sharpening the weapon of our own demise.
This conversation took place shortly after two huge release shows for Mere Survival, for which Wong gathered a 20-piece band, so you'll hear a bit about that, as well as some thoughts on songwriting itself. Wong and Timony also get deep on how their parents' illnesses brought them together, and about self-sabotage and perfectionism, and much, much more. Enjoy.
Hi, okay. This is Joe Wong, and I'm here with
Mary Timony.
Mary, do you remember when we met?
I was thinking about this morning. I actually remember even what you were wearing, which is weird because it's not like I have a great memory, but I do remember meeting you in Chicago with Bob Weston and you were wearing a red puffy coat. You came down to the show.
Okay, I think that would have been 2003.
Yeah. Are you basing that on the coat or the...
I think the coat and my memory, but I think it was... Yeah. When you started playing with Garland Devours.
Was it? With Devin?
Brendan Canty on bass and Devin Ocampo on drums. And then you were also doing your own album that would become X-Hex. But I don't think that album came out yet. The Mary Timony solo album, not to be confused with the band of the same name that you were also in, which is confusing.
Yeah, it's true. It's very confusing.
Does that ever become an issue for you?
Well, no one really knows the X-Hex record, so no. No one really knows that record because the label went out of business like 2 weeks after.
Lookout Records. Yeah. It was on Lookout Records.
So that worked out.
A major cultural force, actually, in the previous decades.
True.
But that was when they were kind of winding down and they were kind of reinventing themselves for a while. Like Ted Leo put out a couple records with them.
Yeah.
So they were kind of branching out from the Bay Area pop punk kind of thing that they were known for in the early days. Guess it didn't work out for them.
But hey, Joe, one thing I know about you is you have the best memory of anyone I've ever known. And I know you pretty well, I would say. I think you're one of my best friends.
But does anybody really know each other? Do we really know each other? I think we do, actually.
That's a constant source of what's it called? Ennui, not ennui. Anxiety, existential anxiety for me.
Do you mean feeling known?
Does anyone really know each other? That's a, huh?
You mean like the sense that you're not, truly known and that you don't truly know someone else?
It's, I have anxiety about like, do we ever really connect with people? I haven't really thought about it that deeply. Like, I feel like connection is so, you never know if you're going to lose it, I guess. So it's, that scares me.
Well, I think you always know that you are going to lose it at some point.
Yes. And then,
but also, yeah, that's what I'm saying. But also, in a way, you don't, because even people that are gone, still, you still feel connected to them, deep connection with them during their life.
Totally. And that's the one thing I want to talk to you about.
About when I die?
No.
Let's get back to this. Okay. So the first time we met, I was wearing my red puffy coat.
Yes, you were.
What I remember about that is you were playing at Shuba's in Chicago, and it was you and Amy Dominguez and Devin Ocampo and Brendan Canty. And then
I just have to say one thing, Joe.
We all slept over at Bob Weston's house. That's why you mentioned.
I should have known to not toot my own horn about how proud I was that I remembered the coat you were wearing, because your memory's insane.
I think music is my mnemonic scaffolding. Like, it's the skeleton for my memory.
What do you mean? That's really interesting.
Like, musical memories are the scaffolding that connect my non-musical memories. Just like,
okay.
Well, if I think about when a particular song was out on the radio, then I can remember, okay, I was in second grade and this is who my teacher was and all that kind of stuff. What it smelled like when I heard the song, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
But what I remember about that too is we went and slept over at Bob Weston's house. Bob had maybe Bob had produced an album for you before then. You knew him?
Yeah, I worked with him on the Mountains record, solo record. He mix of stuff.
And also Corey Rusk came out to the show, I remember. And the reason I remember all this is because Bob, Brendan, yourself, Corey were all kind of giants in my mind. And I don't know that I'd met many of you before. Whoa, it's all these superstars. The other thing I remember is that you were still smoking cigarettes. You had a blue box of cigarettes and Devin had a yellow box of cigarettes.
See, this is what I'm saying. You actually remember like every detail. Like, it's really intense.
Well, what I also remember is looking at all the tapes that Bob had in his house. He had all these reels from bands he had recorded or bands that he had been in. And I thought it was so cool.
But Joe, what were you up to at that point in 2003?
I was a waiter. I was a waiter in Milwaukee at an Italian restaurant. And I was, I was scoring my first film. The first film I scored was called The Yes Men with some filmmakers from Milwaukee. I was playing in a bunch of different kinds of bands. I was not playing rock music at the time. I was playing more
jazz
stuff. Mm-hmm. And I was in a Latin band. And like, I started playing with these guys that had moved to Milwaukee from Senegal. And so I was just doing all sorts of stuff that was not rock related. I think I was, at the time, I thought I was done playing indie rock anyway.
But how long before that? I know you talked about how you had a whole record that you wrote and recorded.
Oh, and that was in 2001 and 2002 that I made that. Yeah.
It wasn't long after that, actually.
Yeah, it felt like much longer because I was younger and any events that happened felt more monumental. So in between, I moved to DC and played with some of the people that we mentioned.
Right.
And it didn't work out. And it was a terrible experience in some ways because I had such high expectations for it. And I thought, all right, this is going to be the band. This is, and you know, it was at a point in my life where I was looking for a band to fulfill multiple roles, like almost like being in a family or a gang or something, like have a bigger part of my identity. Threw everything into
it. That's actually such a good description.
And it just wasn't the right match at the time.
Right.
But that's how we met. And that's why I always remember how that felt really wrong in the moment, but how it led to all sorts of relationships that have been so great. So it's almost like what we've discussed with songwriting. Sometimes you'll spend so much time writing a song and then realize later that it's not right, but you have to do that to get to the right song sometimes.
Right. But it's sort of like the universe was putting you there. It wasn't your ultimate goal, but it so much came out of that. And not only just meeting people, but learning what you don't want to do.
Yeah. And I was pretty depressed, I think, at that point in my life, because I think I was just trying to channel my energies into something. And so I was playing with all these different musicians to try to challenge myself and become better as a drummer at the time. And I just felt the need to work really hard, but I didn't really have a vision of how that would manifest. And it was kind of weird, a weird time, like where I just felt like other friends that had finished school were moving on into their lives and getting good jobs or starting families or doing adult seeming things.
Sometimes when people are like super lost, when are you, not that you were, but the way you're describing it, that lost feeling, like really good things come out of that. It's like a growing period.
Well, I stumbled on what became a career for the last 20 years in scoring.
Yes. So much has come out of that for you.
And playing with all those people was actually really great. I mean, it just broadened my ear and my appreciation for different kinds of music. And then, yeah, it's funny. Only like the next year you called me to tour with you.
Right.
That was only about a year later after we met, because the drummer that you were playing with at the time was going out with another band.
I don't know if we've ever really talked about this, but I totally relate to that period when you're trying to figure out what you're doing, especially as a musician, because it's such a non-traditional thing to do with your life, especially if your family aren't musicians or something. But my time after, when I was like 22 to 27, it was like hell. I was so depressed and like so disconnected from people. Felt like I was fucking up.
That was also the time that you were you were in the band Helium, right?
Yeah. I guess what I mean is more just like right after college, before, maybe for the first couple years of Helium doing stuff. Yeah.
From the outside, I was like, oh, that looks so cool. They're on 120 minutes. They've got it made. They're living the dream.
Yeah. I didn't know what the hell I was doing. And I was really unhappy. And yeah, it was just, it's a mess. I just didn't like that period of my life. Like the early,
I was going to say that really period hard. Lasted, it comes and goes, because I felt.
Yeah, and absolutely.
I mean, it lasted a while. Even after I had some success.
It's really hard.
Then in my 30s, when I first moved out here, I was, struggling to make ends meet, even though I was working on stuff that people saw. I was scoring shows that people liked. But it took a couple years to get established in LA. And it was like that whole feeling all over again, like maybe I made a mistake.
Yeah, I don't feel like I really know what I'm doing, actually.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I'm just trying to be happy, really. I don't know what I'm doing.
Are you?
You know, it's like music. Music is the only thing that I know makes me feel like a normal person. Because if I'm not doing that, I don't know what the fuck to do with myself. I feel like an alien in the world.
What was happening with me in my early 30s is not only was I broke, but I also wasn't getting any joy from playing music. So that's when I wouldn't mind being broke if I was getting that same amount of joy that I used to get out of music. If I was feeling that new relationship energy that I had, you know, the feeling that lured me into this life.
Right.
In my early 20s, I was like, I just need to find the right people to start a band with. I just need to get the right project going.
But that's something that I totally relate to.
And then in my 30s, I was like, I had found cool people to play with. I was playing with Marnie Stern at the time, who's great, and I respect and loved. And I was just like not feeling any joy. I was feeling like a muted sense of satisfaction maybe from playing and playing as well as I could at the time, but I don't know. And so it was scary, and I had to, it took me a minute to admit it. And I was trying to decide, I was like, well, it would be disrespectful to all the other people that are doing this if I can't either figure out what the issue is or do something else.
Yeah.
When you say you don't know what you're doing, what do you mean? You don't know what you're doing with your life trajectory, or you don't know what you're doing as a musician, or?
I don't know what I mean, Joe. It's not like I have some grand plan of, you know what I mean? It's just like, oh, I like making stuff, and I don't know. I'm sort of like a kind of person that goes through the world just going on. I guess I'll just do this. I don't have like this grand scheme.
I don't think that's so uncommon, you know?
Yeah.
I think a lot of the folks that I've spoken to for my podcast are really good at surfing through life in the sense that they have really good intuition. And so whatever the world throws at them, they can react and find a path forward. But there are some people I've spoken to that are really strategically minded and plot their success in a very deliberate way.
Different brains.
And I think I have a tendency to want to be like a strategist, but I also don't think that it works. It's not 100% effective. I think I see myself in between those two extremes.
I do too, actually. I think that's one of your skills. You have a lot of skills, Joe. You're incredibly talented.
Thank you.
Yeah, no, I see you sort of, actually, I think that's one thing that's cool about you is I see you wearing a lot of different hats and have a lot of different skills with all this music stuff that you play, songwriting, like film stuff, directing a 20-person band, like there's a lot of things that you're really good at.
I think it goes back to the period where we first met when I was waiting tables, because I was also fixing computers, teaching drum lessons. And yeah, I just started scoring for film, tried doing all these different things because I needed to in order to make ends meet at the time, but also because I like having lots of different irons in the fire. I think I'm more creative if I'm not throwing everything into just one thing. I would come up with an idea for a song when I was fixing a computer or something, but not when I was trying to come up with an idea for a song. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
It's almost like
absolutely
leaving space for my subconscious mind to do its thing.
Right. Super. I don't know how to do it without doing that. I mean, I've seen you go through huge changes, actually, because when I first started, when we went on that tour.
So we first played together in 2004, 2005.
Right. We went on that Spoon tour.
For your album, X-Hex. Yeah, we were opening for Spoon.
We went on tour in my Subaru station wagon.
And that was really, that was when we really got to know each other because it was just the two of us in a station wagon traversing the country for a couple weeks.
Yeah.
It was a pivotal event in my life because I really didn't think I was going to play in rock bands anymore. And then it seemed like really fun to go out with you because I was a fan of your work. And I was also a fan of Spoon, so I thought that would be fun. And I had never played shows that large before, really. Spoon had just released an album called Gimme Fiction, and it was their biggest album to date. And we were playing to maybe about 1,000 people a night or something like that. And it was really exciting and fun.
I can't believe that I was fearless enough to like just play with two of us, like drums and guitar. That seems so hard to me now. It's like really intense. You can't mess up because everyone can hear it, you know? So we did that, and then for I would say years, maybe, you mentioned to me we would have these talks every once in a while that you wanted to make a record.
I think the first thought of it came when we were on that tour. I said, hey, maybe I should try writing some songs.
I remember having these long talks about you wanted to make a record of your own songs, and I would encourage you and we'd talk about it and stuff. It was sort of a theme. And then suddenly something happened and you got the guts and you started and you did it.
Yeah. Well, it was longer than 6 years. It was like 15 or something.
Oh, shit. Really?
What changed was I had gotten comfortable scoring. So I scored hundreds of hours of well, maybe not quite that much, but like, you know, I'd written hundreds of pieces of music in the intervening time for films and TV. And I also, when I was going through my early 30s depression, as part of a kind of proactive step to figure out what was happening and to try to determine a path forward, I started a podcast called The Trap Set, where I basically was trying to work through my own neuroses with drum heroes. And, you know, the feeling at the time was that I wasn't connected to the joy of making music. And I wanted to figure out if other people had experienced that phenomenon. And I kind of, in my mind, was like, well, if everybody else is still having a blast and this is limited to me, then maybe it just is an indication that this is not the right path for me and I should just go back to school and do something else that I'm interested in. But the funniest thing happened is just by asking the questions, well, I found out that a lot of people go through phases like I was going through, but that was almost secondary. It was almost just asking the questions and connecting with people kind of reawakened that joy in a very unexpected way. I mean, I felt like I was connecting with people through conversation in the same way that I would aspire to connect with people by playing music with them. So that, I think, served as the bridge from helping other people tell their stories to being comfortable enough to tell my own. And I say comfortable enough because I was not comfortable at all. If, as you remember, when I started it, I kept trying to self-sabotage.
Yeah, I do remember that. Yeah, you were really feeling it. I remember. You wanted to convince me not to come out.
Feeling the hate for myself?
Yeah. No, I remember like viscerally you were nervous. Yeah. But you worked through it, which is so cool.
Well, I think you were a big part of it because you'd made a bunch of albums despite suffering from the same kind of self-doubt that I was.
There's a part of me that was like shameless and would like put out stuff even though, but I wouldn't, I would fuck it up. I would put it out, but it would be what I considered. Yeah, I would fuck it up in different ways. Anyway, we all have our own.
Well, because then
neurotic. Yeah.
Because then if people didn't like it, maybe it was safer. less hurtful because you could agree with them that you hadn't.
Yes. That's what I did.
It wasn't like a complete representation of what your vision was.
Yes.
For it.
I did everything halfway for a long time. I like made sure it was a little bit junky and that I didn't actually like it because it felt safer. Totally crazy.
I mean, I think that was also just part of an aesthetic at the time. With lo-fi stuff, particularly records that were on Matador, which is the label you were on early on, is like,
that's true.
You know, they're putting out 4-track albums by Guided by Voices where it was like, just a verse is a song, or, you know, even Pavement was sloppy.
It's true.
You know, even though you know, in retrospect, you're saying that it was kind of a self-sabotaging move.
Yeah.
It actually happened to line up with the aesthetic of the 90s in indie rock.
Well, you're right. Maybe it was why I took it on so readily. But okay. Well, here's a question for you. Another thing that I think was going on in your life around then was what happened with your dad.
Yeah, my dad had a stroke when I was 29 and it wasn't clear whether or not he was going to recover, and I had to kind of step in and help run his life for a while. And my siblings were all younger than me, and eventually everybody was helping out, but for a while I was taking on the brunt of the work. So that was traumatic to see somebody, well, to kind of have that role reversal of becoming the parent type figure or guardian over my own parent. And then just having to reckon with all the skeletons in his closet that I was exposed to during that time, because I had to go through his life and kind of sort through things. And I think it simultaneously made me more conscious of my desire to want to be in a position where I'm not vulnerable in the same way that he was, because he didn't have insurance when he got sick. He just didn't have his life very well organized, which was shocking to me because when I was growing up, he was much more put together. I think the stroke was kind of the culmination of his life falling apart. So there was this whole, there was like a new awareness that I started caring about making money or, you know, being more organized and being more thoughtful with how I set up my life. But then also the opposite was true in the sense that I became aware of how things can be snatched away from you at any moment and that I was not manifesting my dreams and that I needed to try that because who knows how much time we have.
Yeah.
So it was like this simultaneous awareness that certain things matter a lot, but also nothing matters.
Yeah, that's why I wanted to talk about this, because I think we share this in our lives recently where we, you know, we had a similar experience. And I think you went through it first, and I was watching you deal with everything with your dad, and it was super intense. And then it was my turn, and I had this very similar thing with my parents that just happened in the past 5 years, where they both got sick at the same time, and I'm just me taking care of them for 5 years. Yeah, it was like really dramatic. My dad got dementia really fast, and then I had to suddenly be the caretaker for them. And it was a lot. It was really stressful.
It was really hard, but I'm grateful that I went through it because it made me feel closer to my dad than I had in years. And I feel like you had a similar experience.
Yeah. No, that's the silver lining, is all the stuff we get out of it. You have to go through really hard times sometimes in life. And if you know, the good thing about it is you get stronger and you grow and you learn and stuff, but it doesn't mean it doesn't hurt also.
I think in both of our cases, it made us closer with the people we were taking care of.
Yep.
And I think for me, it helped me prioritize things and also let go of things that didn't matter in my life.
I was like, I'm not going to sweat the small stuff, because like every day I have to decide, you know, which psychiatric hospital do I take my dad to? Like, you know what I mean? Because he was having like lots of crazy behavior stuff. So like worrying about that stuff, I'm not going to worry about like, what recording studio do I go to? That's fun. I think like my priorities completely shifted.
I think it also makes you aware that it doesn't really matter. Like you go in and you'll make it work, no matter which studio you go to.
So that's another thing we've sort of really bonded over, I think, or helped each other through. I can say you absolutely helped me so much through that time, because you had been through it.
Yeah, and I think even though you hadn't been through it, having someone to talk to when I was, I mean, we started the first album when my dad was still here, but right. he wasn't in good shape. And I think even that first album is sort of about the experience of losing people. Right. It wasn't deliberately that, it was just, that's what came to mind when the lyrics were materializing.
Right. Yeah.
I don't know what any of the songs are about when they're being written usually.
I don't think songwriters usually, that doesn't work. I don't know anybody that decides. I mean, maybe for some people. I don't. So I think
you probably could, as a game, you know, if you were doing it like an oblique strategy, like write a song about the color blue, you know, or whatever.
Maybe. Some people probably do that. I can't do that. I have to just completely dream, you know?
Yeah, I think, you know, one thing that I've taken from scoring films and TV and applied to the way that I make records now is all of these strategies to get my conscious mind out of the way so that my subconscious mind is kind of driving the bus. So like working quickly is one. Mm-hmm. Having someone to be accountable to is another. Like, I feel like when I'm working with you on my record, you're the lifeguard and I'm jumping in the ocean, and then vice versa. If I'm producing you,
right.
I even use a timer when I write songs, and the, also the idea of writing a lot and picking later, like letting future me be the judge and like that's just really not good. Judging it and just trusting that, the songs will come. Like, you know, for my job, I have to write, you know, up to 6 episodes of music every week. So there's not time to like think about, oh, what's going to happen with this? What's, you know, what's my plan? I know when I need to deliver the stuff, and then I set up my studio and everything in it in such a way where I don't have to think. Everything's ready to be recorded at any given time, and then I just move through it.
Yeah.
And I think it actually ends up turning out better creatively too than if I were to painstakingly deliberate over every single note that I write.
Yeah. I have to get, same thing. I don't, slightly different, but I think I have to get to the point where I just write a bunch of junk and 99% of it I don't want to use, and just once in a while there'll be something cool.
Yeah, I've heard it referred to as fishing. I've heard it referred to, I remember Buzz from the Melvins called it panning for gold, which I thought it was cooler than fishing too. Yeah. But it's all an acknowledgement that the songs are external and that our goal is to become better at harvesting them from the environment in some way. The more you try, the luckier you'll get.
Yep. I don't like treating it like a job, like a habit, like I have to do it every day for a certain amount of time. Sometimes that works, but it's also important to acknowledge when it's not working, because I think I've tried that and just written some boring things. So I like going through periods of 3 years when I don't write songs. I don't know. Maybe I'm just being lazy, but
no, I think it's probably different for everyone. I mean, here's the thing is that your mood can affect your perception of it too. So sometimes I'll be having a bad day, but I have to write like 20 pieces of music for a show.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I remember thinking like, ugh, all this stuff fucking sucks. What am I going to do?
Yeah.
And then I listen the next day. I'm like, actually, it's pretty good.
And
sometimes I write something and forget all about it. Then I hear it like a month or two later and I'm like, oh, that's actually good.
Huh.
And then I can hear where to go with it in a way that I couldn't before.
Huh. That's interesting.
That author George Saunders says that when he writes a novel, it's written by, you know, several hundred versions of himself, like a team of selves. Mm-hmm. And I relate to that a lot.
Yeah. Only way I can do any songwriting at all is like by asking myself later if I like something. Like, it's usually later that day or the next day, and I get an answer. My brain will answer it without me. I actually don't even ask. My brain will say yes or no. You must approach songwriting slightly differently, because I feel like with the scoring thing, you probably don't have enough time to ask yourself because you got to get it done.
Yeah, and the difference too with that is that it's not my ultimate vision. So it's liberating in a way, because I just turn it over to somebody else and I'm like, do you like this? It's also vulnerable in a different way, because you're asking someone to judge you and to tell you if it's working for them, which is why it's really important that you're working with the right collaborators, or that I am at this point, that I'm working with people that I'm on the same wavelength with, so that when they give me feedback, I can trust that they're right. And that if I listen to them, it's going to make it even better. The reason why it took so long for me to release any songs that I wrote is because the part of me that was judging was so roided up for so long. It was like on steroids, roided up. It was like a roided up drill instructor that hated everything that came its way. So that's my relationship with self had to change in order for me to feel like I even was worthy of releasing work into the world. And I think that's a constant negotiation, just wondering if it's any good, wondering if we're an imposters, or if, you know.
One thing that shifted during my whole time with caretaking my parents is my relationship to that stuff changed. So that it used to be that I sort of sided with my mom, who was sort of critical of me being a musician, and that I, part of me felt like I am doing something that doesn't matter. So that made it harder to take myself seriously, fully, 100%. But as soon as the roles reversed with my parents, and so that stuff started shifting. So now one thing that's happened, and then also the pandemic made me realize that how much music helps me. I don't know what I'd do without it if I couldn't listen to like music that I love. Like the thing that I like to do the most, really, you know, like lately I've gone really into Jethro Tull, and that's one of the brightest spots of the last month for me. It's just, you know, or when we were all sitting around the Airbnb the other day, listening to all of our favorite prog and jazz stuff, like that should mean so much to all of us, you know, as people and as musicians, and I don't know, or good books that we love, or good TV shows that we love, or good movies that we love, or good art, or all this stuff.
But in my case, I always knew that, but I always felt like nothing I did could ever approach that level of greatness of those kind of things that we love. And so that's why I was always just like, I'm not
qualified. That sucks.
I don't think that it's quantifiable in that way anymore. I don't think I thought that back then on an intellectual level, but on an emotional level. Yeah.
No, that is absolutely wrong. Well, wrong. And I'm so glad that you're getting in there and working on not telling yourself that horrible thing anymore, because it's not true.
I think it was basically there to try to keep me safe, right? Like try to protect me.
Well, we all have our own negative things that play in our heads, I guess. So yeah, I get that. Sucks. But I'm so glad that you're letting it go.
Should we talk about the shows that we just played?
Okay.
Because we were talking about some of these things during that experience. But how did you feel about, we just played an album release for my new album in LA and another show in Seattle, and we did some radio stuff also.
Uh-huh.
And it doesn't sound like a lot to some of you out there, maybe, but we were playing with like a 20-person ensemble, so it was like a big undertaking for me anyway, to organize that and put it all together, and you know, it was a substantial investment of time and other resources.
What an incredible experience. My God.
What did you
record is great.
Oh, thanks.
And
yeah, what did it feel like for you to do that, to play those shows? And like, what's your takeaway?
Yeah. No. Okay. So yeah, getting to meet,
cause you've played hundreds or thousands of shows at this point.
Yeah. I've never played in a band with 20 people before.
Yeah.
And 20 like virtuosos, what an incredible experience playing with all of that level of talent. That's everybody involved in the band is so good. My God. Yeah, that was really fun, Joe. You were so calm through the whole thing. I guess you prepped a lot, but I can't imagine organizing a tour like that. It was so fun.
Well, I was constantly asking myself if I was like, am I going overboard because I don't believe in the songs enough that I could just do it by myself? On the one hand, I was manifesting this dream come true of getting to play with lots of my favorite musicians and realizing the songs the way that they came to me. You know, just I was just realizing them in the way that I originally heard them when we were writing the album. But then the negative side of me was like, are you being overindulgent by getting this many people? And are you hiding away in organization when you should just be writing more stuff? That's how the negative voice manifests now. But now I know how to kind of interact with that negative voice in a more constructive way. And it's not steering the ship as much. But the answer is there's nothing better to put resources into than presenting this music the way I wanted to present it.
Yeah.
And simultaneously, I'm also thinking of ways of presenting it in without that doesn't require 20 people. You know, it's like it doesn't have to be either or. Yeah. And if you would have talked to me 30 years ago, I think it was a literal dream to play with some of the people in the band. And I would have, at the time, right. I would have dreams where it was like I'd be at a show for somebody that I loved, like Helium or Soundgarden or something like that. And the drummer broke his arm and someone would come on the PA and ask, does anybody know all the songs? It's like this, it's like literally a dream come true. Not that I was playing drums, but just getting to play with everybody. I mean, I've found that that's a common dream among drummers anyway, from doing my show, but the nature of music as a social vehicle, and how some of the artists that inspired me when I first started playing, then I've gotten to know them and collaborate with them 30 years later. That's awesome.
So cool.
It's great. And that's, I think it's the nature of music feeding back onto itself, or the nature of humanity recycling itself. Even the rehearsals are fun. Like
so fun.
There were more people at the rehearsals than there have been at several shows I've played over the years.
They're all so great.
They're all great. What I really like is just the people.
Well, the one thing that I've learned is as much as that seemed like a good idea when I tried to do stuff on my own, it's just never going to be as good as if I'm playing with really awesome musicians. It's always going to be like 50 million times better.
I think it took you a while to feel.
Yes, that's one of my issues. Yeah.
Prepared to play with other, actually, well, when we were making your album, one of the people that we brought in was Dave Maddox, who's one of the great drummers of his generation. And in fact, your favorite drummer of all time, maybe.
Yeah.
And
yeah, I'd say, yeah.
I think you had a panic attack after he said yes.
No. Okay. So during when my dad and mom were sick and it was the pandemic, and I would be working on some songs for record, and I'd go on these long walks and listen to stuff. And, you know, sometimes we would talk or go on walk, and I'd talk to Joe. And a couple times you were like, hey, Mary, what's going on with your song? And I was like, well, I don't know. I'm trying to figure it out. And you're like, well, hey, you should get Dave Maddox. And it just didn't even register with me. It was like, you should get Jimi Hendrix or so. I was like, yeah, that would be cool, but there's no way that would ever happen ever. And then I think what happened is since everything was so fucking insane in my life with my parents being sick and all, so I was just like, well, what's wrong with me? Of course I want to do that. So then one day I was talking to you and I was like, hey, let's ask him. And you did, because you know him from interviewing him for the Trap Set. And literally
within
an hour, you
10 minutes,
called
I think
me.
It was.
10 minutes.
Yeah.
He was like, he said, sure.
Then you freaked out.
Well, then I had to actually deal with my inner issues, which was I'm not good enough to play with good musicians, which is what my damage, because it's scary to put yourself out there and to be around people who are really good. It's scary to me because of my psychological problems, because of my mental illness. And I definitely had a number of panic attacks. And when we were in the studio, I had to go outside and sit on the ground for half an hour because I was losing my mind. I was so nervous. I don't even know why now. I needed exposure therapy to allowing myself to do something that I wanted to do for myself. And Chad is so fucking good, and you're so good.
Chad Moulter, the bass player.
Literally just the idea of allowing myself to be in a room with three people who are taking me seriously on these songs and wanted them to sound really good. And it wasn't like a punk rock thing that we were doing really fast. Anyway, it was just a new way of doing something. And I had a number of panic attacks.
It's interesting and, because you know, you grew up in the punk rock scene of DC, which is revered by many. I mean, you just went on tour with a band, Hammered Hulls, in Japan, and Hammered Hulls is on Discord Records, as was your first band, Autoclave, in the late. Right. And the one thing that's interesting about you is that you didn't get into Jethro Tull and then get into Minor Threat and then, you know, whatever. You were immersed in the scene, in the DC punk scene. And then later in life, like maybe in your 40s, you started getting into classic rock.
Hey, no, I'm go backwards. And like,
for me,
I always liked it. I always liked it.
Well, I loved that stuff when I was a younger kid. And then by the time I was like 14, I would never have admitted to even liking it.
Classic rock?
Yeah,
classic
it rock. Wasn't cool. Okay. Or even anything mainstream. Like I've told Matt, I told Matt Cameron this, like I got into Soundgarden, but then Soundgarden had an album on SST. And then once I discovered SST and started ordering stuff from their catalog, I was like, fuck major labels. Soundgarden sold out, you know?
That was the 90s, though. That was the 90s. I was such a snob in the 90s. I was like, I would never work with a major label.
Well, the funny thing, though, the reason I bring that up is because I think you conflate, like, to you, punk rock represents, like, a strain of laziness or maybe lack of commitment to your idea. Like you were saying it almost like as a dismissive thing earlier when you said, yeah, it's not like a punk rock thing.
I mean, no. Okay, so that I don't mean traditional punk rock. I guess what I referred to then was that this thing that I do in my brain where I'm like, it's good enough. I don't have to like try to make this better because I'm a punk. Do you know what I mean?
I think that, the interesting thing is for me, I think I was using the opposite cop out where it was like, this isn't perfect, so I'm not going to do it or not put it out or not. So it's almost like we were kind of moving in opposite directions.
Isn't that funny? We're both,
For me, perfectionism was a way of hiding.
I would show up, but just not be there. I was checked out a bit on my own art. Wait, when you say perfectionism, you're saying that just kept you from doing it, making your own art.
It was a way of, it was a place to hide. Yeah. I mean, it was just like, there are recordings by John Coltrane readily available. If you can't make something as good as that, then people should just buy John Coltrane records.
Horrible.
I know. I don't totally disagree with that in some ways. I mean, like people should buy John Coltrane records, of course. Because he's the best. But it was like a form of ego masquerading as selflessness or something.
No,
but
it's negative self-talk.
Well, the place where I'm at now, it just has to be coming from a place of trying to honor the songs that I'm hearing in my head and put them out into the world. And everybody is uniquely qualified to offer something, and it's incumbent on me to try to find what it is that I'm qualified to say.
I've gotten to the point now where I'm insane enough to think that it's our duty. I mean, if you got a story to tell, please tell the story. I just think it's people's obligation.
That could mean like, playing it in a hotel lobby to two people, or going to a nursing home and playing it for folks there, or it can mean trying to put out an album and like market it. It can mean any of those things.
As you pointed out to me recently, think of all of the musicians that we don't know about from the last million years.
Yeah, before the history of recorded music. And the idea of recording music on a physical format or even, you know, on digital files is a blip in the history of music.
Think about like, you know, 500 years ago, if you wrote a song, I guess you'd probably be lucky if it got passed around the town or it turned into some kind of oral tradition thing.
This idea that we're building a legacy by making records is kind of phony because, the records.
No one's going to know in 200 years.
Yeah, probably not. And even if, but that's not what matters. And so that's what we were saying, I think, in that earlier conversation about all the people that have made contributions. The real legacy is however it affects humanity as a ripple over time or whatever, or how it affects the world.
We're all contributing to this giant web of stories and knowledge and things that we've created.
I think it's comforting to know that most musicians, even most great genius level musicians over the course of history, are forgot. The songs are not ours. We're just borrowing them for a second and ushering them into the world in some way.
I totally agree. It's like we're a radio station.
So it almost doesn't matter. The ability to continue or to sustain a career doing it to a large extent depends on whether or not people like it or are willing to show up or pay for it. So that's what causes lots of conflict, I think, with artists. That's just the system that we're in right now, you know, for anything that you offer to the world.
That pretty much wraps it up.
That wraps it up. Nothing matters and everything matters.
Yes, both things.
Well, thanks for talking with me today.
Thanks, Joe.
All right, I'm going to hit stop on this.
Okay.
Thanks for listening to the Talkhouse Podcast, and thanks to Mary Timony and Joe Wong for chatting. If you liked what you heard, please follow Talkhouse on your favorite podcasting platform and check out all the great written pieces at talkhouse.com. This episode was produced by Myron Kaplan, and the Talkhouse theme is composed and performed by The Range. See you next time.